the splendor of the King.
Let now the earth rejoice, oh, the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. I tremble at his voice, tremble at his voice. How great is our else will do. nothing else could take your place. To Him the one who prays. Help me find the way, bring me back. Song. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Amen? Let's sing it together.
This is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is
messages that the Lord has given him, and we're very inspired, and we're thankful that and we're expecting that the Lord will speak through him to each and every one of us. David, please.
Once again, thank you for bringing Becky and I from Egypt to share and to tell our stories and to honor and glorify our God and be a part of this wonderful conference. We have just been thrilled to see what God is doing through home in many countries, and we're always excited to find out all of the things that God is doing. I don't think that we know even the smallest part of what God is doing in the world. We get to get little glimpses in our lives, but the more we travel about, more countries that we've been in, the more we see of what God is doing. I think we have very little understanding and idea of the magnitude of what God is doing around the world. And it's just a great privilege to see more of it. I want this morning to give, to share a biblical and experiential perspective of why God allows Christians to suffer, and in the context of what's happening in the Middle East, but not only in the Middle East, and something that I think can help all of us to really put our faith and trust in God and serve Him effectively. Becky and I spent more than 30 years working in the country of Gabon, Central Africa, and we started with a dispensary and a bad attitude, started to change those things, and over the years with a wonderful team that God provided, wonderful African partners, that dispensary turned into a 160-bed hospital where in over the last 20 years or 15 years, more than 20,000 people prayed to receive Christ. I wish they were all in churches, but probably a third of them are. And it was just an unbelievable ministry. We made many mistakes, and God, you know, He works in spite of our mistakes as we follow Him and trust Him. He was a great teacher. He taught us many things. And we thought that that's where we were going to sort of finish out our ministries and ride off into the sunset. And lo and behold, God took us to Egypt. I mean, we were just shocked. And we still are a little bit stunned when we wake up in Manouf. It's at the Harper Memorial Hospital in the morning. It's sort of like, whoa, we're still here. But we have found that when you decide to follow the Lord and entrust your life to Him, the adventure just never ends. It never ends. And I'll talk about that a little bit too. But as a year ago, as we took off from an airstrip in a small mission airplane, and as we flew away, we saw through the window the hospital buildings recede in the distance. We wondered, what exactly is the Lord? What can the Lord do with just two people like us at our stage in life? I mean, I could see that God could do a lot with a young person, a young couple, just full of energy and life and the latest training and so forth. And but here, God has chosen to use us and move us to a new place. And also, I wondered, at what point does God say, okay, you're done, relax, enjoy life, take a break until I take you up to heaven? I mean, that's sort of what we had in the back of our minds. After all, we're over 60, and people are supposed to retire at some point in their lives. It's probably good for everyone that they do. It doesn't mean you quit working or serving the Lord, but we do move on. We don't stay in all the top positions of leadership forever. We want to create leaders and build young leaders up and turn things over to them. So this is kind of the questions that we might have in our minds, and maybe the assumptions that we have in our minds that are not truly God's ideas. There is a philosophy in our world that is very strong, and I think that it's growing, particularly in this country, and that is that this here is all there is. This life is all that there is. You only live once. Get your bucket list out and get through it before it's too late. And when those things don't happen, when we don't get a chance to live life to the fullest, to see the farthest regions of the world, to ride camels in Egypt and maybe elephants in Africa, there can be anger against God. There can be a kind of bitterness, like, you know, God didn't fulfill His part of the bargain. Not only that, the conviction that the most important thing is in life is to live it to the fullest can lead us to abuse other people, to mistreat the very people who raised us, who love us, to abandon our obligations to our parents, to our friends, even to a spouse, maybe to abandon our children. People do crazy things so that they can live life to the fullest. I thank God that those are not His dreams for us. But God does have dreams for us. there's much evidence, and God talks about it a lot in Scripture. In Ephesians chapter 2, 9 to 10, I referred to this in a message yesterday, but I want to come back to this theme. Salvation is not a reward for the good things that we have done, so none of us can boast about it. For we are God's masterpiece. That's kind of hard to believe, isn't it? I mean, I know all the things that are weaknesses in my life. How can I be God's masterpiece? Well, the good news is that He's not done yet with me. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do the good things He planned for us long ago. Another translation says this: we can accomplish the works that He prepared for us from the foundation of the earth. Think about that now. God had a dream for me. He has a dream for you. And we can refuse that dream, or we can accept it. Another verse is Isaiah 64, 4. For since the world began, no ear has heard, no eye has seen a God like you, who works for those who wait for Him. 1 Corinthians 2, 9. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love Him. We can't even imagine what God has prepared for us. It starts now. It starts here. But it's just the beginning. The problem is that it doesn't often look that way. And I know that you've experienced that. About 3 years ago, there was a young woman who came to our hospital in Gabon, 23 years old. She had lost quite a bit of weight over the previous 2 months because of pain when she ate. And very strange symptoms in a 23-year-old. She had started to throw up after she had meals. And so we got some x-ray studies, and we can't do CT scans at our hospital in Gabon, but we can do other imaging studies. We did an ultrasound as well, and we saw that she had some kind of a mass in her pancreas. It wasn't very big, but it was in her pancreas. And we just don't see that very much in young people. And so after we had pretty much isolated it to something outside of the, we did an endoscopy and looked inside her stomach and her duodenum, we could see there was something compressing that. So we decided that we would take her to the operating room and do an exploratory laparotomy. And so this was a young Christian woman. She had come to Christ only about 1 or 2 years previously, a first Christian in her family. She was very enthusiastic, following the Lord, growing rapidly in her faith, and then this had happened to her. Her name was Pulcherie, which is a French name. And in the operation, I discovered that she had a tumor in her pancreas. Everything was sort of stuck down around her, the part of her intestines that's right beyond the stomach, and it looked like it's some kind of maybe even tuberculosis. It's very common in our region. I've never seen tuberculosis of the pancreas, but it was very suspicious. Took some biopsies, couldn't really find anything that looked malignant, and toyed with the idea of removing her pancreas, which would be an enormous operation for our little hospital. I'm not sure she would have survived, and the diabetes and everything she would have had afterwards. So made the decision not to remove that, but I was troubled by it. We just bypassed that part of her intestine so that she'd be able to eat. And following surgery, she gained weight. She did very well. The pain went away, and we waited for the biopsies to come back. We have to send our biopsies to the United States to get the results, and so it was about a month before I got the result, and I was absolutely stunned to learn that she had adenocarcinoma of the pancreas. And I felt very badly, because now it was going to be much more complicated. I have another general surgeon there at our hospital, Keir Thielander, and the two of us talked about what we should do. We called her back and talked some more with her about it, decided to get sent her to the capital city for a CT scan, and when she came back with the CT scan, it was obvious that we could not resect the tumor. And so we explained all this to this young woman, 23 years old, young Christian, less than 2 years old in Christ. And she said, well, if God's plan is to take me home, then I'm ready to go, but I'm going to ask God to heal me. Would you pray for me? We encouraged her to do that as well, and the elders of her church came and anointed her with oil, as is commanded in the scriptures, and prayed that God would heal her. All of our team prayed for her. We came on rounds, we would see her, and we would pray for each day, and she was confident that God was going to heal her, but her symptoms did not improve. They continued to get worse. Now, I told you that she was the only Christian in her family, and her father had abandoned the family when she was only 5 years old, so her mother had raised her. Mother wasn't a Christian, because she wasn't getting better, her father suddenly appeared on the scene, along with her brother and a sister and her mother, and they all said, "We need to take you to the traditional healer, or witch doctor, if you will, because this is clearly being caused because of a curse that somebody has put on her. We have to take care of that, get rid of that curse, she'll probably get better." And so they encouraged her to go to one of the local healers in the nearby area that was very famous for his witchcraft and invoking the spirits to bring about healings and so forth. She said, "No, I won't go." And they said, "No, you don't understand, you're dying. The doctors have said that they can't heal you and cure you, and you've prayed to Jesus and he's not healing you, so obviously we need to take another track." She said, "No, I will not go." What she said to them was, "If Jesus chooses not to heal me, I will go to be with him, but I will not participate in anything that does not give God alone the glory for my healing." 23 years old. So one afternoon, her father drove up to the hospital. When nobody was looking, he ran in, picked up his daughter. She only weighed about 80 pounds by then. Took her out to the car. She was screaming and said, help me," drove off. Took her off to somewhere, we didn't know where, but to some witch doctor. We put out the word, we called the police. They said, "Oh, it's a family matter. We can't interfere in this kind of thing." And she was on a lot of pain medication as well that allowed her to sleep. He just took her off with nothing. Finally, after about 2 weeks of inquiring around, we found out where she was. And she was up near a church plant that Becky and I went to in one of the villages every Sunday. So on our way home, we stopped in that village, drove down this little trail path, and found where they were holding her. She was in this building that had been built, kind of a dormitory for people who were having treatments by the witch doctor. And I went in and asked where she was, and her mother came out of this room in that building. And I said, "Is Pulshuri here?" And her mother said, "Yes." And then she opened the door, and Pulshuri crawled out on all fours. And when she saw me, she just started weeping. And I picked her up, she didn't weep very much, took her over to a chair that was on the side there, just a crude wooden building. A lot of other patients, they were sitting there watching, and she just wept. And so finally I said to her, "Pushuri, do you want to go with me back to the hospital?" I said, "You know, I'm bigger than anybody else here. I'll take you and put you in the car, and we'll drive you home." And her mother kind of looked at us, and she wasn't going to stand up to me either, but Pulshuri said, no, she said, "I want my father and my mother to take me back to the hospital. I want them to do it. I don't want to run from them." And so I prayed with her, and I said, "If you change your mind, just send the word, we know where you're at," and left. She hadn't slept for almost 2 weeks since she left because of the pain. And she'd lost a lot more weight. So we all prayed for our whole hospital staff, prayed for her. About 5 days later, 6 days later, she showed up at the hospital in a taxi. And what had happened was that the police had heard that this witch doctor was there. They went to check out his papers. He had come across the border from the Congo. He had no visa to Gabon, and so they had told him that he had to leave. And so her father was planning to take her across the border into Congo to continue the treatment. And when she heard that, she took her walking stick and she started swinging it around. God somehow gave her the strength, got on her feet, walked 50 yards down to the road. When anybody came near to her, she swung her stick, and just then a taxi drove up, she got in it and came to the hospital. She died about a month later. But she died glorifying God, and everybody in that hospital, all the members of our staff, were deeply touched because she said again, I will not participate in anything that does not give God alone the glory for my healing. But this was not the end of Pulsuri's life. This was the beginning. This was the beginning, and she knew it when she passed away. This understanding became very real to me the day that I lost my parents, and I shared that last night, but I'll share it just in brief today. I was 19 years old, a pre-med student at Geneva College, and my parents were in Vietnam trying to reach a people group that did not know Christ. And there was a tremendous battle all across Vietnam. On one day in 1968, they overran the city where my parents were living, and when they tried to surrender after 3 days, with a white flag, my parents and four other missionaries were gunned down with machine guns and killed on that day. And I was very angry at God. I went back to my room and I got on my knees and I said to God, why? What were you doing? Why didn't you take care of them? You were the ones who sent them. You told them to go there. You say in Psalm 91 that you take care of your people. I knew all those scriptures. You know those scriptures. And I don't know what I expected God to do, but God answered me. He spoke to me that day in an audible voice. And it didn't even register at first because I was so angry with him. He said to me, David, do you trust me? And actually I didn't, but I sure wasn't going to tell him that. So I said, of course I trust you. I've been a Christian since I was a young boy, and I gave my life to you, and I want to serve you as a medical missionary. That's why I'm here. And again, David, do you trust me? And I argued with God. I said, the problem is not with me. I'm not the one who screwed up. You're the one who was supposed to be taking care of them. I don't have to answer this question. Third time, David, do you trust me? And I understood that God was not going to explain. You know, the God that we follow can be very confusing. And his ways can be utterly bewildering. But I have to also say that his ways can be utterly and totally wonderful. He just doesn't explain everything. And that's what I wanted. But I realized he wasn't going to tell me, and I needed God, and as I was weeping there before him, I didn't know what to do. So I finally said to God, okay, fine. I will trust you. That's fine. I trust you. And just like that, the Holy Spirit said, okay, if you trust me, thank me right now. And I'm not saying that every terrible thing that we go through in our lives, God asked us to say thank you right away, even as we're trying to process that. But I was lying to God, and we both knew. I couldn't do it. And so I was there for a long time, and finally I realized that I was not going to serve God in any capacity if I could not settle this issue. Because if you can't trust God when everything goes wrong, you can't trust God. I mean, that's just the bottom line. I wanted to trust him, and I wanted to serve him. And so I finally said, and I didn't know if he would accept that, I said, fine, okay, God, I can't feel thankful, but I will say the words. And I said then to God, the hardest words I've ever said in my life, I said, thank you for taking my mother and father. And in that moment, my life changed, because God came down and just filled that room. And I just sensed his love for me and his arms about me. I knew that I had a father. I'd always had a father who loved me. Human father was a wonderful father, but he was gone. Not only did God meet me on that day and show me how much he loved me, and he drew me into his heart. And he reminded me that because of his resurrection, I would see his parents again. I knew in that instant all these things just like that. I would see them again. It wasn't over. It was just the beginning for them. And that understanding was the beginning of my life's work and God's dream for me. God has a dream for all of us. That's what Ephesians 2, 9 and 10 says, the verse that I just read. And it is impossible to serve God with the anointing of the Holy Spirit and if we do not trust Him when there's hardship and we understand nothing. It is impossible to serve Him effectively with the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Because God's ways, He does not explain. He just says, follow me and I will be with you. Life is very short here on earth. And we forget that these bodies that God's given us is not the finish, are not the finished product. There's an awful lot of stuff now in science about how wonderfully we've evolved and that we're just, you know, going to continue to evolve in another billion years if the earth doesn't get destroyed or something. But the Bible calls these bodies temporary. Tents, actually. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1, the Apostle Paul says, for we know that when this earthly tent that we live in is taken down, that is, when we die and leave this earthly body, we will have a house in heaven, an eternal body made for us by God Himself and not by human hands. If you want to really believe in evolution, that would be what I call directed evolution. God takes us to a whole new level. These temporary habitations that the Apostle Paul talks about, they all wear out. They will all wear out. And all the efforts we make to feed them and house them and pamper them and dress them for every conceivable occasion and repair them as they wear out, they still fall apart. And they will all end. Now, I think it's important that we work at it and keeping as strong as possible and take care of our bodies. I joined a spa or health club a while back, and I started exercising, and I bent and twisted and gyrated and jumped up and down and groaned and perspired. But by the time I got my leotards on, the class was over. But it's still worthwhile trying to stay in shape. Because I think that while we're here, while we're still here on this earth, why not serve God? Why not serve others? And the stronger that we are, the more able we are to do that. In Colossians 3, chapter 3, verses 1 to 4, I don't think this is all four verses. I think this is verse 1 and 2. The Apostle Paul said, since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. For you died to this life. Your real life is hidden with Christ in God. That doesn't mean that we are of no earthly good, but it means that we live in the present, but our hope is in the future. This is not all there is. This is just the very beginning. The very, very beginning of an existence that's going to go on forever. And the dreams that God has for us do not stop at the grave. They go on beyond. They go on forever. Paul is saying that we are to live in the present and our focus on serving Jesus, but our perspective has to be eternal. And if our real life is hidden with Christ in God, then the dreams that God has for us will be unique and they will be amazing and they will reflect God's desire to make us partners in bringing lost people to faith in Jesus. God's dreams for us will always include making us like Jesus and they will always include drawing us closer to God. If I, on that day, that God was challenging me to trust Him without understanding, if I had said, you know, God, it's fine. I'm going to kind of run my life. I'll go to church, and I still believe in Jesus, and, you know, He's the Son of God. But this is my life, so I'm going to take care of these things. I'll direct it. I could have done that. I wouldn't lose my salvation. The Bible doesn't teach that. but I would never have become intimately in love with God. Because God, as we obey Him, as we follow Him, He draws us in. And I have to tell you, that is the best part. Getting to know God, becoming so aware of Him that you could almost talk to Him, you know, if people don't think you're too strange while you were talking to Him along the way. But the awareness of God's presence is one of the things that happens as we obey Him. I used to think that praying to God meant you closed your eyes and you were really focused and you prayed with great passion. You told Him everything you could think of, everything that was on your heart and mind. Those are all good things. All my requests. And then when that was finished, I was done. But one day, as I was praying, I kind of ran out of things to say. And there was some time left. You know, I was having a little devotional time. So as I was sitting there, suddenly, God dropped something into my mind. And He said to me, "David, this has really been a great time together. Let's do this again." Well, you know, one of those random thoughts going through your mind, you're talking to yourself. No. No. As we learn to listen, as we still our hearts and learn to listen to God, He talks to us. And why not? He's our Father. He talks to us. That's what happens as we trust God and we follow Him and we embrace the dreams that He has for us. What is keeping you from embracing God's dream for your life? You know, His dreams is that we would also have an undivided heart. David said in Psalm 86, he said, "Give me an undivided heart." We're born with divided hearts. We're born with things in our hearts that take us away from God. But as we embrace His plan for us, His dream for us, He starts to reveal those things to us. And He helps us get rid of those things. He helps us take those idols out of our hearts and away, and so that we can love God. But we do sometimes fear things, and we're afraid of what God might do with us. You know, if I entrust myself to God, oh man, you know, He might make me marry someone awful, or maybe not marry at all, or have no children, or go to some awful country. I could never be separated from my family. We set up all these little things because we're afraid. And sometimes we're afraid because there may be trouble in some country right now. There's all kinds of news about Egypt. It sounds like when you watch the news that if you go out in the street, you're going to get hit with a rock or blown up with a Molotov cocktail or something. And it's true. There are these events in Egypt today. But the news does not want to report what's really happening throughout the country. They don't want to give you a general picture of you know, if 1,000 people are demonstrating and throwing rocks, the other 90 million are, I suppose, not important. And so we let fear start to dictate whether we're going to follow God or obey Him or accept the dream that He has for us when He starts to reveal it to us. My brother, Sharif Hanna, and his wife Mary Lou, and they said, "We're going to come to Egypt and work with you." His friends all said to him, "You're crazy, you're crazy." And we start to believe those lies, maybe. Let me just tell you a story from Gabon. We had a ferry. Our hospital was on the wrong side of the river from the main part of the town. The hospital was actually, the mission was actually started before the town even existed. And the town grew up on the other side of the river, and later a road was built to the town, and a road was built down to the river, but to get across the river, there was no bridge. So they had this hand-pulled ferry, and missionaries built it and maintained it, and you drove up onto this thing with your car, and it would spring leaks from time to time, and there were just a lot of adventures on that ferry. But it was the only way that cars could get across with patients for the hospital. And there was a big canoe that could go across, but it sometimes filled up with water. So it was very important for people to go back and forth across that bridge to get to the hospital. Well, the population wanted a bridge, and the government was very slow to oblige them. So some opponents to the government or opposition party decided that the way that they could get the government to act and endear themselves to everybody in the town was to cut the cables and let the ferry float down the river. And so they did that one night, and we woke up and we couldn't get across the river except in little canoes. And these were little dugout canoes, and so that all that day, for weeks, people were being transported that way. And one of the other thing was that after cutting the cables and sending this ferry down the river, they said, anybody who touches that ferry, we're going to kill them. So we thought, well, maybe we better pray about this for a while before we do something too radical. And time went by, and there were some near accidents on the river with patients who, if the canoe had overturned, they would have drowned. And it was a very difficult time. Well, as we prayed about this, this Canadian group showed up, these engineers, and they said, well, we've been hired by the government to do a study on building a bridge, but we need your ferry. Can we go down the river and get it? We'll bring it up. We have heavy equipment. We'll pull it out of the water, and we'll put it back in the water. We said, praise the Lord, and answer a prayer. Isn't this wonderful? And so they did. They pulled this thing out downriver and brought it up in a huge truck and put it back in the water. That night, they all went into town to celebrate at a bar, and a bunch of these guys who'd been hired by the opposition party went and beat them nearly to death. And they said to them, if you touch that ferry again, you'll be dead. So there it sat. And no cables put back up. It just sat on the other side, tied up to the shore. And another couple of weeks went by, and I was praying about this. And one time, it's dangerous to pray, because sometimes God will ask you to be the solution. And sure enough, as I was praying, the Lord said, why don't you go fix it? Why don't you go? And I thought, no, can't do that. But I kept praying, and the Lord said, I will protect you. So we called a meeting of all our missionaries, and it's a little awkward, you know, announcing to your colleagues that the Lord told you to go fix it, something, do something. It's really, you know, nobody's going to say, what did he say and exactly, and how do you know this is the Lord? But because they weren't feeling that way at all. And I just said, well, I think the Lord wants us to go fix it, and that he will protect us. Will anybody help me? Well, there was one new missionary who still didn't speak French, and he volunteered to help me. He said, okay, Saturday we'll go down, and the rest of you guys please pray. So on Saturday we drove down with a whole bunch of tools, and I didn't have a real clear idea of how we were going to do this, but this other guy was pretty good with mechanical stuff. And so we got a bunch of pulleys and things and drove down there and got out. And there were a couple of young men who were down there guarding the place, making sure that nobody messed with the ferry. And so we walked down to the ferry and said, hi. And they said, yes, hello, doctor, what are you going to do? I said, well, we're going to hook up this ferry so that it can bring sick people back and forth across the river. Oh, really? They said, yes. These guys had these clubs, some about the size of baseball bats. And they said, well, I'm sorry, but you can't do that. And I said, well, you know, God told us we should do this. And for some reason, that didn't impress them. And so they said, well, look, if you do this, we're going to beat you up. And my colleague over here didn't speak French. He said, what are they saying? And I said, well, they're just, you know, saying that they'd rather we not do this. And I didn't translate it exactly right. I said, well, you know, this is really important that we obey God and we do this and the patients who are suffering. So how about this? You guys let us put this thing all back together and we'll get it running. And then afterwards you can beat us up. And I didn't make a joke of it or anything. And the guy just looked at me and he said, are you serious? I said, yeah, we need to do that. And he just stood there. I said, okay, thanks. So we got in a canoe, went to the other side where it was tied up, and started working. And they stood on the other side and said, "We're going to really pound you guys when you get done," you know. And my friend was saying, "What are they saying?" I said, "Oh, I'm not too serious." And so we hooked up this first cable and brought it across the river and put the tree on the other side. You had to put pulleys on it and everything. And then these guys are really, now they're three or four of us. And they're saying, "Listen, you know, we're gonna really pound you guys. They're gonna have to take you to the hospital afterwards." I said, that's okay, just let us finish." And the Lord just gave us I did finally explain to my colleague what they were saying. But he just said, "You know what, let's do this. Let's just do this and trust in God." And so we worked that whole day. We got two cables across there, one for a pulley, and another one to pull the thing across. So it took us all day. About 4 o'clock in the afternoon, we finally got the thing done. And I had had my car on the other side of the river, and so we brought my car back over. And these guys, they were all standing there around, you know, just looking really threatening. And when we finished, we got out of the car, and I said, "Okay, you can beat us up now." And they just looked there, and finally one of them says, "Doctor, if we were to beat you up, the whole town would come and kill us." I said, "But this is the only car. Your car's the only one." I said, No. It can't be that way." I said, "This is for the sick people. They have to be able to come to that. We're not going to let them go through." I said, "So tell me now, how's this going to work? They're going to come with their dying family member, and you're going to say no?" I said, "What do you think they're going to do to you?" "Well, okay, we'll let the really sick people go through across the river." I said, "Okay, that's fine." And I thanked them, and we drove away. And that ferry, nobody bothered them, anybody from crossing that ferry again. Many times our fears are just the threats of the devil. He's a roaring lion. He doesn't always have teeth. And we need to distinguish. When God says to us, "I want you to do this," we need to put our faith and trust in Him, and not be directed by our imagination. God is excited about our future. He is not excited about the past. What excites God the most is about what He is going to do. In Isaiah 43, 15 to 18, He said, "I am the Lord who opened a way through the waters, making a dry path through the sea. I called forth the mighty army of Egypt with all its chariots and horses. I drew them beneath the waves, and they drowned, and their lives were snuffed out like a smoldering candlewick," the past. But then He says this in verse 9, "But forget all that. But forget all that. It is nothing compared to what I am going to do, for I am about to do something now. See, I have already begun. Do you not see it?" God exults about our future. And I believe that this is a prophecy for what is going to happen in the Middle East. What has happened in the past is the past. But our God, He loves the people of the Middle East. Not just the Christians, those who He is waiting to be His sons and daughters. God is always working. And our story is a part of His great story. C.S. Lewis said, "You are never too old to set another goal to dream, or dream a new dream." Let me give you, just in closing, 5 biblical reasons for doing everything that God calls you and asks you to do. The first one is that your service to God and to others will change the world. You may not see it in your lifetime, or you may not see how much it changes the world, but even a drop in a pool sends out ripples. Your service to God and to others will change the world. Prayer, giving, compassion, sharing, witnessing, discipling, they are all about partnering with God. He takes our little feeble efforts and He magnifies them. He makes them happen. Moses had a staff. He held up the staff. That's all he had to do. He held up the staff and the waters parted and the miracles happened. The second one is your service to God and others will save lives. Now, I'm not talking about the kind of life-saving that it's claimed doctors do and nurses do and firemen do. That's prolonging life. We prolong life. God has given us that great privilege.
But only Jesus saves lives. Only Jesus saves lives. And as we share the truth and the gospel of Jesus and people come to him, those lives are saved forever. Thirdly, your engagement in God's plan will draw you closer and closer to God and will teach you to depend on him for all your needs. There's no other way to grow in God's school than to follow him and to embrace his dream for you. Fourth, your obedience to God will make you progressively more like Jesus. It's inevitable. If you follow Jesus, if you walk with him, he'll change you. He'll change you inside out. And finally, embracing God's dreams for you will bring you happiness and joy. They will bring you happiness and joy, even in the midst of suffering. My parents' martyrdom transformed my life and my ministry. That was the day that I learned to trust God and embrace the pain that came from taking up my cross to follow him. That was the day that I understood God's incredible love for me. And that gave me a confidence that has never left me. That was the day when I fell in love with God. That was the day that I understood how deep is God's commitment to win lost people, even if it means taking the lives of his faithful servants, because it's just the beginning. Do you not see it? This life that we're living now is the very, very beginning of what God has planned for each of his children. And God's plan for us begins when we make Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior, and the Holy Spirit makes us the light of the world. But we have to trust him. We have to trust him, no matter what happens, to follow him, embrace his dreams. His dream for us always includes making us like Jesus, drawing us closer to Jesus, and bringing the nations to him to be his future sons and daughters. Father, I thank you that you have given us the privilege, the greatest privilege in history, to partner with you in finding your future sons and daughters around the world. You have given us the privilege of becoming like you. You have given us the privilege of coming to know you intimately. Thank you, Lord. And I just pray that you would speak into every heart here, that each one would say to you, "Yes, Lord, yes, I'm not afraid. I will follow you." Amen.
You know, David, it struck me that you, what a great walk the Lord has walked with you after the loss of your parents, and I know Becky lost her dad, and the way he's changed this tragedy into triumph in your life is very meaningful to us. As a church, what we're going through and some of the difficulties we're going through. But I also want to say that it struck me that in a way you lost very precious family members that for a little while. But the Lord's plan for you and Becky was to expand your family in such an incredible way. Africa and now the Middle East, and you have a big family that keeps growing, and in a way it's sort of compensated hundredfold until you see your parents in a very, very touching way. So just here there is a sense that we're your family, and it's a growing family around the Middle East. Now you have a big Middle Eastern family, and may the Lord bless you. We're just very thankful to have you in our midst, and we're going to have more of you. And we thank the Lord for you, truly, for you and Becky. Now, we're going to the next part of our service, which is the last part, and I want to thank you all for being with us. This second part is going to be in Arabic, but if you don't know Arabic, do not fret. We have translations, and they can, some of the people can help us out there so that you can put the sets, and you can hear the message with our dear brother Ramiz Atallah, who heads the Bible Society in Egypt. He's going to give it in Arabic, and you can hear the translation for those of us who don't know that great language, Arabic. the English, the youth can have their own, unless they want to stay, it's up to them, but, you know, if someone wants to stay, it's optional, but there would be the youth English Bible study back there, if you want to go. And then we'll resume the service with us. Brother Isa is going to lead us in worship, and we're all ready to proceed in worship during this last session.
Amen. Sabah al-khair. وأهلا وسهلا بالجميع في بيت إلهنا. ولما بقول بيت إلهنا ما بقصد المبنى, بيته نحن مبنيين كحجارة حية. فأهلا وسهلا بالجميع في بيت أبوك السماوي. أمين. تعال هيك في البداية نقول ها آتي بطيبي فوق رأسك, هبني الآن أعرف حق قدرك, عوضا عن شوكي في إكليلك واتكئن رأسي على رأسك. رنمها مع بعض. هآتي بطيبي فوق رأسك, هبني الآن أعرف حق قدرك, عوضا عن شوكي في إكليلك, واتقي أن رأسي على صدرك. إذ كسرت قلبك من أجلي أنا, ها قارورة الطيب يكسرها هنا, عند قدميك وادنهما, حيث راحتي لا ولا عنا. هآتي بطيبي فوق رأسك, هبني الآن أعرف حق قدرك, عوضا عن شوقي في إكليلك, على صدرك. لا يكن في قلبي شاركا لك, لك كل قلبي, لك وحدك, ولينكسر قلبي ليشبع قلبك, كل شهوتي في مجدك. هآتي بطيبي فوق رأسك, هبني الآن أعرف حق قدرك, عوضا عن شوقي في إكليلك, واتقي أن رأسي على صدرك. دعني أتلف نفسي عند قدمي, وأحظى دواما بملء نظيري, وأسعى ضعيفا وأستند عليك, حتى كل المجد يرجع. ارفع صوتك معي. هآتي بطيبي فوق رأسك, هبني الآن أعرف حق قدرك, عوضا عن شوقي في إكليلك, واتقي أن رأسي على صدرك. دعني أكرم اسمك وأرفعه الآن, لئلا تمضي الفرصة وينتهي.
كما مرة. دعني أكرم اسمك.
دعني أكرم اسمك وأرفعه الآن, لئلا تمضي الفرصة وينتهي الزمان. فمريم وحدها قد فازت بالنشان, وطيب المريمات فاته الأوان. هآتي بطيبي فوق رأسك, أحضن عن شوقي في جليلك واتكي أن رأسي على صدرك تعالوا نوقف بس قبل ما نختم هاي الفترة نوقف كلنا مع بعض ونسبح اسم الرب مع بعضنا البعض نقول له إلهي ملكك أبدي مدلي إلهي ملكك أبدي وعظيم اسمك في الجبروت قدامك يهرب عداك ويصير لينا الملكوت ونصرخ كلنا مع بعض نقول له ملكي يا ملكي قدامك نطرح تجان وحدك صاحب السلطان تعالوا مع بعض رنم هاي الترنيمة إلهي ملكك أبدي وعظيم اسمك في الجبروت قدامك تهرب عيدك ويصير لينا الملكوت مالكي يا مالكي قدامك نطرح تيجان مالكي يا مالكي
وحدك
وحدك صاحب السلطان وحدك كاشف الأسرار كلامك سفدي حدي بينور أحسى القلوب ويغير أفكار فتاك مالكي يا مالكي قدامك نطرح تيجان مالكي يا وحدك صاحب السلطان مفيش زي عمل ايديك ولا في زيك هنا هقضي حياتي اسجد ليك انت العالي وانت الله مالكي يا مالكي قدامك نطرح تيجان مالكي يا مالكي وحدك صاحب السلطان أنا بطلب ما أشتاك
وريني ما أشتاك
وإذا كان في عيني قشور شيلها بيدك
أنا بطلب ما أشتاك وريني ما أشتاك
وإذا كان في عيني قشور شيلها بيدك يا يسوع انت احتياجي بتمسك بيك وانت فرحي وتاجي انا عيني عليك يا يسوع
انت احتياجي
بتمسك بيك وانت فرحي عليك
أنا بطلب ما أشتاك وريني ما أشتاك
وإذا كان في عيني قشور شيلها بيدك أنا بطلب ما أشتاك وريني ما أشتاك شيلها بيدك عمانوئيل عمانوئيل الله معانا
عمانوئيل عمانوئيل
الله معانا
شعبك يعلن بيك إيمان
شعبك يعلن بيك إيمان يمسك بوعودك
انت رعينا وكل مالينا وبنغمرنا بجودك شعبك يعلن بيك إيمانه
بسلك بوعودك انت راعينا وكل ما لينا وبتغمرنا بجودك عماله ايه عماله ايه الله عالى دمك غطاني برك كساني حبك نشاني ملأ قلبي أغاني دمك غطاني برك كساني حبك نشاني ملأ قلبي أغاني يا سبب وجودي
في سجودي
فادتني بدم صليبك فكت قيودي يا سبب وجودي
في
سجودي
فادتني بدم صليبك
فكت قيودي وحدك فدية حقك حرية نلتي في حبك براءة وحياة أبدية دمك غطاني برك كساني وحبك نجاني ملأ قلبي أغاني دمك غطاني
برك كساني حبك نجاني
ملأ قلبي أغاني
قوله من قلبك معي
عايش في خيرك ولا هعبد غيرك حاضر في حياتي وأيامي ومالينا
عايش في خيرك ولا بعبد غيرك حاضر في حياتي وأيامي مالينا عبيرة ساكن في قلبي ملكك يا ربي لا تسيبني ولا سيبك وده عهدي أبدي
حقيقة بتعجز الكلمات في الصباح اني اخبركم عن اخي وحبيبي اخ رامز والعمل الهائل اللي عم تعمله جمعية الكتاب المقدس في مصر وفي كل انحاء العالم العربي. انا تعرفت يمكن لاول مرة حبيبي رامز باول حياتي الروحية وخبرته اختباري واكتشفت انه في شخص من عائلتي وساكن كازن من مصر عنده نفس الاختبار وشجعني كان هو مختبر الرب وراجع من عائلي اللي ولت دو بكندا كنديان ايجيبشن رجع على مصر ليخدم وهذا كان من 34 سنة يعني يمكن وأكثر حوالي 34 سنة وبعدها من خلال 23 سنة الماضية كان هو رئيس جمعية الكتاب المقدس في مصر، رب استخدمه بشكل هائل واستخدم العمل المبارك يرهو من امتياز انه ينكرز بإنجيل المسيح للخلاص. حابب يخبرنا أخبار عن مصر وعن العمل هناك، يشارك معنا روحيا، رب يبارك.
شرف كبير ليا أكون معاكم النهاردة، وإن شاء الله المترجم هيفهم لكنة مصرية مصرية كندية. النص بتاعنا في روميا الأصحاح الخامس من آيات 1-5، يمكن من أعمق الآيات تعليم الرسول بولس عن علاقتنا بربنا والتبليغ. فروميا 5:1-5، خلونا نسمع كلمة ربنا. ولو بتكلم سريع شوية على الترجمة من فضلكم حد يقول لي، عشان أنا ساعدتي بتكلم بسرعة. فإذ قد تبررنا بالإيمان لنا سلام مع الله بربنا يسوع المسيح، الذي به أيضا قد صار لنا الدخول بالإيمان إلى هذه النعمة التي نحن فيها مقيمون، ونفتخر على رجاء مجد الله. وليس ذلك فقط، بل نفتخر أيضا في الضيقات، علمين أن الضيق ينشئ صبرا، والصبر تزكية، والتزكية رجاء، والرجاء لا يخزي، لأن محبة الله قد انسكبت في قلوبنا بالروح القدس المعطى لنا. آمين. الآيات دول بتتقسم، الآية 1 و2 هما فعلا ثمار التبرير، آية 3-4 الضيقات طريق للمجد، وآية 5 ضمان الرجاء. هقولهم تاني، ثمار التبرير 1 و2 الضيقات طريق المجد 3-4 وضمان الرجاء في 5. فخلينا نبص عليهم واحدة واحدة ونجرب نفهم. خصوصا عادة القيادات المسيحيين قدام الضيقات عندهم طريقين ممكن يطمنوا الناس. أول طريقة، وغالبا دي اللي معظمنا بنلجأ إليها، هي تفسير الأحداث. يعني في حدث وحش، في ظروف صعبة، فبنحاول نفسرها بطريقة تريح اللي قدامنا. يعني حد توفى، حد عيان، فنتكلموا عن حد عيان أكتر منه. فبنقول طب يعني أوكي، واحد يعمل يحصل له مش حادثة، طب في حادثة أوحش. يعني بنحاول نقول له حاجات، وغالبا غالبا ده بيكون طمأنين مزيف. شخص تعبان عنده مشكلة وإحنا مش عاوزينه ما يواجههاش. عاوزينه، احنا في مصر لما حصل مثلا ان الاخوان المسلمين استلموا البلد، ناس كتار في الكنائس قعدوا يفسروا الطريقة دي، يعني كان ممكن يكون اوحش، يعني كان ممكن ليه؟ عندنا مبدأ ان المسيحي مش مفروض يتألم، مش مفروض ربنا يسيبه في ظروف صعبة. فاحنا بنحاول نفسره انه فعلا ربنا قصد خير، وظروف دي مش صعبة زي ما انت متخيل. الاسلوب الثاني الموجود في الكتاب المقدس اللي بيقولوا بولس هنا عن الافتخار في الضيقات وكده، هو عكس كده خالص. بنحاول نثبت الايمان. الظرف صعب، الضيقات حقيقيه وانت في محنه، لكن ايمانك بيقول لك ان الله معنا، ايمانويل معانا، ومفيش حاجه تفصلنا عن محبتنا بربنا، واللي ربنا طالب مننا في الحياه اللي احنا عايشين فيها ان نمر في الضيقات. فبنواجه الضيقات، بنواجه الالم بحقيقيه، لكن في اطار وفي مفهوم ايماننا المسيحي. فدول الاتجاهين. والنهارده بولس بيعمل الطريقه الثانيه، بيواجه المشاكل الناس جوه بطريقه ايمانيه، ما بيحاولش يفسرها او يخففها. ف من الحاجات اللي احنا واجهناها في الفتره اللي فاتت وانتم سمعتوا، انه في يوم 14 أغسطس الإخوان المسلمين أو الأنصارهم حرقوا حوالي 85 كنيسة في مصر، منهم كمان مؤسسات مسيحية زي ملاجئ ومدارس ومكتبتين من بتوع دار الكتاب المقدس. احنا كان بقالنا 130 سنة في مصر دار الكتاب المقدس بتخدم بالكتاب المقدس، ما فيش ولا مرة حد حدف طوبة على فيترينا.
في 130 سنة، وفي يوم وليلة مكتبتين اختفوا بشعة وعنيفة وتخض. وكان متوقعين الإخوان أن اليوم ده هيكون في رد فعل المسيحيين ضد المسلمين، يحرقوا محلات مسيحيين، يحرقوا جوامع، يضربوا مسلمين، عايز أقول فتحصل حرب أهلية بين المسلمين والمسيحيين في مصر. دي كانت الخطة. والمفاجأة الكبيرة أن قيادات الكنيسة ومنهم البابا تاودروس الكنيسة القبطية وقفوا وقالوا إحنا مش هنواجه الشر بالشر، ومسيحنا لما كان على الصليب غفر للي كانوا بيصلبوه، فإحنا رد فعلنا هيكون بمحبة، رد فعلنا هيكون إن مش هنعمل حاجة. وفعلا قالها كمان، قال لو التمن اللي لازم ندفعه كمسيحيين إننا نعيش في مصر حرة، نعيش في مصر دينا حقوقنا، هو إننا نضحي بالأماكن دي اللي اتحرقت بنديها قربان لربنا. فكان اتجاه غير عادي، ما كانش في زعل، ما كانش في ما حرضش الشعب المسيحي على العنف، بالعكس، وما طمنهمش، قال لهم احنا بنقبل دي كتضحية قدام ربنا. ده كان نوع التفكير اللي بولس بيعلمه هنا، نواجه الموضوع ونعمله بطريقة مسيحية عميقة. عدم رد فعل المسيحيين انقذ مصر، عشان لو كانوا مسيحيين كان في رد فعل كان مصر اتحرقت فعلا، لكن المسيحيين هم فعلا انقذوا مصر في رد فعلهم الهادي والإيجابي اللي فعلا خلى المسلمين المعتدلين كلهم يقولوا مش معقول، انتوا فعلا في فرق، في حاجة مختلفة فيكم، ما بتتعاملوش كطبيعتنا اللي الشرقية اللي بتاعت الشرف، واحد أهان شرفي يبقى لازم أنا أعمل حاجة. ففعلا دي كانت معجزة، ومعجزة قوية. خلينا نبص بقى بطريقة عملية على النص قدامنا في آية 1 و2، بيقول فإذ قد تبررنا بالإيمان لنا سلام مع الله بربنا يسوع المسيح. السلام هو في الماضي، حاجة اتعملت لما المسيح مات على الصليب، لما قبلنا المسيح موته على الصليب من أجلنا، فلنا سلام مع الله. دي حاجة حصلت في الماضي وإحنا مستمرين فيها. وبعدين بيقول إيه؟ الذي به أيضا قد صار لنا الدخول بالإيمان إلى هذه النعمة التي نحن فيها مقيمون. فإحنا دلوقتي عايشين في إيه؟ الخلاص في الماضي، وإحنا عايشين دلوقتي في النعمة، إحنا في عصر النعمة، فالنعمة هي اللي إحنا عايشين فيها كل يوم. وده اللي بيخلينا نقدر نعيش حياتنا. رد فعل المسيحيين الإيجابي في اللي حرق مبانيهم كان بس عشان هم عايشين بالنعمة، والنعمة دي اللي خلتهم يقدروا يتعاملوا بالطريقة دي. والرجاء هو في المستقبل، فبيقول إلى هذه النعمة اللي نحن فيها مقيمون. وبعدين بيتكلم في بعد كده عن انه الرجاء هو حاجة نأمل إليها، ونفتخر على رجاء مجد الله. فالرجاء هو اللي بنسعى إليه، الخلاص هو الأساس اللي ابتدينا منه، والنعمة اللي هي عايشين فيها دلوقتي. ملخص ممتاز، ويريت نحفظه لحياتنا المسيحية كمؤمنين في العالم اللي احنا فيها. من المكتبات اللي اتحرقت دي المانيا، انا فاكر افتتاح المكتبة، وافتتاح المكتبة كان حفلة كبيرة، ووزعنا عهد جديد ملفوف بورق هدية لأي حد جه. فعرفنا بعدين عن واحد من خلفية غير مسيحية عدى وشاف الناس بيوزعوا هدايا، فعمل نوقف في الطابور كأنه مسيحي وأخذ الهدية، راح البيت فتحها وكان متضايق قوي، انت لقيت عهد جديد، فرماه في الأوضة عنده. بعد سنين في يوم كان تعبان فتح الكتاب وابتدى يقرأ فيه، بعد سنتين مثلا ثلاثة، ومن خلال قرايته في الإنجيل عرف الرب، وراح كنيسة وتعمد. القسيس اللي عمده جالنا وحكى لنا القصة دي بعد 3-4 سنين. قد إيه كلمة ربنا اللي الراجل سرقها، يعني ما كانش من حقه ياخدها، ما كناش بنوزع، ممنوع توزع على ناس مش مسيحيين إنجيل، لكن هو أخده كأنه واحد منهم وما اهتمش بيه، لكن ربنا افتقده من خلال كلمته، أداله النعمة دي اللي من خلال الكلمة. فيعني احنا بنحس ليه مهم ان مكتباتنا تكون في الشارع، تكون متاحة، الانجيل يكون متاح. عندنا 15 مكتبة في الشارع في مصر، وصلوا لنا ان نعمل مكتبات تانية كده، عشان الشخص العادي اللي ماشي ممكن يدخل وياخد انجيل، ممكن يدخل ويلاقي كلمة ربنا في الساحة المصرية بطريقة، ودي نعمة وبركة احنا عايشينها في مصر. واحنا هنستمر بالرغم من الاعتداء ان نوسع ونشتغل، واسكين ربنا هو هيحمي، ولو حصل خسائر يبقى زي ما حصل مع الكنائس دي نديها للرب كتضحية له، كتمن شهادتنا كمسيحيين. ما نقولش إن يعني نواجه الواقع، احنا عايشين في ظروف صعبة. فتحنا مكتبة السنة اللي بعد الثورة في منطقة الجيزة، كانش عندنا مكتبة. الجيزة فيها حوالي 7 مليون شخص وما كانش في مكتبة مسيحية في الشارع، واخترنا مكان كويس وقصاد المطرانية بتاعت الجيزة، وجنبنا كان في صيدلية. قلنا الصيدلية مكان آمن، يعني محل هيكون كويس، عادة الناس دول كويسين. بعد ما ابتدينا لقينا ان كل الصيدلية دي اصحابها سلفيين، فالمقاول بيشتغل تخض خالص، فقال مش هنقول لنا حاجة مسيحية. سألوه ايه ده؟ مكتبة. مكتبة هنعمل مكتبة. فما حطناش يافطة، ما عملناش حاجة لغاية الاخر، وكانوا خايفين قوي. وفي الاخر وهو بيحط اليافطة كان خايف، فعملوا افتتاح. فجم الجيران اصحاب الصيدلية جم زاروا المكان، فشافوا الناس مخدودين شوية، قال ما تقلقوش احنا جيرانكم واحنا سلفيين، لكن احنا سلفيين ما بنؤمنش بالعنف والحاجات اللي بتشوفوها في التلفزيون دي، واحنا هنا عشان نحميكم، بنعتبر ان ديننا بيقول ان لازم نحمي الجار، وانتوا جيراننا واطمئنوا هنحميكم. فناس اطمنوا. اسبوعين بعد ما فتحنا جاء شهر رمضان، وانا عطين ولد واحد في المكتبه، مكتبه جديده مش ما يقدرش معناش نحط حد تاني معاه، مش عارفين هتبيع كويس مش هتبيع. فجي في وقت رمضان ما فيش اكل خالص، فهم ديريو اصحاب الصيدله، فجم قالوا له يا ايمن هتاكل فين؟ هتجيب اكل فين؟ تتغدى ازاي؟ هو ما كانش فكر في الموضوع. قال لهم ليه؟ قال عشان ما فيش اكل، لازم تمشي غايه حته بعيده قوي بعد ميدان الجيزه عشان تلاقي اكل، وخساره تقفل المكتبه، هتقفل المكتبه عشان تروح تجيب اكل. قال لهم ما عارف ليه. بص احنا عندنا 2 فراشين، 2 اوفيس بويز، كل يوم هنبعت لك واحد تقول له انت عاوز ايه، يروح هو ويجيب لك الغدا بتاعك كل يوم. الاوفيس بوي صايم، هم صايمين، وكل يوم في رمضان كان بيروح ويجيب لهم الاكل. النعمه، النعمه اللي احنا ايه عايشين فيها، صح؟ مش دي نعمه؟ في مشاكل وحشه، لكن لازم نتكلم عن النعمه دي. نعمه دي كلمه ربنا اللي بيقول لك في نعمه، فما تقلقوش علينا في مصر، احنا عايشين في نعمه، والنعمه مش عشان الظروف صعبه، النعمه عشان الرب معانا في الظروف دي اهم حاجه. الظروف ممكن تحسن زي ما عندكم هنا كل حاجات ايزي، لكن لسه ما عندكمش سهوله في الشهاده المسيحيه. انا بقول في مصر اسهل لينا نكون انجيليين في مصر، نتكلم عن الانجيل ونتكلم عن ايماننا، ما فيش مشاكل الشواذ، ما فيش مشاكل كل الحاجات اللي بتواجهوها هنا، ما فيش حد يقول لك تو بي بوليتيكلي كوركت، ما تقولش وما تقولش. احنا معروف اننا مسيحيين ومتوقع اننا هنشهد بايماننا المسيحي، فالوضع مختلف. طيب فقلنا ازاي فعلا ثمار التبرير هي السلام في الماضي، النعمه في الحاضر، والرجاء في المستقبل. ايه هي بقى النقطه الثانيه من اعداد 3-4؟ هي الديكات طريق للمجد. الديكات مش غلطه، الديكات المسيح لو ما كانش اتألم ومات على الصليب ما كناش نقدر النهارده نعيش في النعمه، ما كناش نقدر نكون عندنا سلام مع الله. فاللي بان للناس كانها كارثه، كانها يعني حاجه نهايه الطريق، كانت بدايه خلاص العالم. فالضيقات هي طريق للمجد. وتعريف الضيق هنا هي ممكن تكون الكلمه اليونانيه، ممكن مضايقات او الاضطهاد او الشدائد، يعني كلمه تحتمل ضيقات، بمعنى انت عندك مشاكل في شغلك في حياتك، عندك مشاكل حد باضطهاد، وعندك مضايقات، ناس بيتدخلوا فالكلمة. فبيقول ايه بقى؟ حاجة غريبة قوي، بيقول احنا مش بنفتخر على رجاء المجد، بينقل في آية 3 بيقول وليس ذلك فقط بل نفتخر ايضا في الضيقات. ازاي نفتخر؟ وكلمة نفتخر هي كلمة نبتهج او نفرح. طب ازاي نبتهج؟ ازاي نفرح في الضيقات؟ ليه؟ حاجة غريبة، نبتهج في الضيقات. بولس كان بيكتب لمسيحيين مضطهدين في الإمبراطورية الرومانية، عاوز يديهم تعليم. فاكرين قلت لكم في الأول إيه؟ في طريقتين نتعامل مع المشاكل، نفسرها بطريقة تطمن، أو ندي تثبيت للإيمان حقيقي بيساعدك تواجه الواقع على أساس إيماني. فاللي بولس بيعمله هنا بيدي المؤمنين البرمجة، الفكر، المفهوم ازاي يواجهوا الضيقات بطريقه مسيحيه. فبيقول بل نفتخر ايضا في الضيقات. طب ليه يا بولس؟ ازاي تفتخر بالديكات؟ انت يعني تحب تتعذب؟ قال لا لا، عالمين ان الضيق ينشئ الصبر، والصبر تزكيه، والتزكيه رجاء، والرجاء لا يخزي. فانا عندي لوجيك، عندي منطق ليه ببتهج في الضيقات، عشان في نتيجه للضيقات دي، مش هوصل للنتيجه دي الا من خلال الضيقات. محتاج الظروف الصعبه، محتاج الضيق، محتاج الشدائد، محتاج الاضطهاد، عشان يعني المسيحيين في مصر لما اتحرقوا مبانيهم ومسكوا نفسهم وما عملوش رد فعل سلبي، الضيقات دي بنت فيهم ايه؟ فكر مختلف، ايمان مختلف. مش خايفين دلوقتي، تعالى احرق مكتبه مره تانية، احنا هنكمل. ما تقدرش توقف المسيحيه. وفي صور كتيره كنت عايز اوريها لكم النهارده بس ما جبتهاش، ان بتشوف الناس بيصلوا في الكنائس المحروقه. حرقتوا كنيسه بكنيسه شعب الله، هنصلي ما يهمش، مفيش شبابيك، مفيش حاجه، احنا هنجتمع هنا شعب الله. ممكن تحرق المبنى، مش تحرق الكنيسه. فالكنيسه بناها المسيح ومش هتتهرق. الضيق زي المضاد الحيوي، الانتي بوديز، بتاخد الانتي بوديز دي عشان تقدر تواجه المشاكل. فاحنا بنفتخر في الضيقات عشان الضيقات الانتي بودي بتاع ربنا بيدينا الدواء ده عشان يساعدنا ان نتغلب على الحياه. فهو زي دواء بتاخده عشان تتغلب عليه. والضيق هنا بيقول بينشئ الصبر او المصابره او قدره الاحتمال. ومن اهم الحاجات اللي احنا محتاجينها في العالم، خصوصا الناس عايشين في مكان زي مصر كده، هي المصابره او قدره الاحتمال. اي واحد يسوق عربيه في مصر محتاج نعمة من ربنا، محتاج يكون عارف انه عايش في النعمة. من السهل قوي يفقد سلامه، سهل قوي تفقد سلامك. واحد بيعدي قدام، واحد بيطلع فوق، واحد بيجي قدامك. واوحش حاجة انت ماشي في طريق والطريق ترافيك، يعني ماشي بشويش، it's two lanes، يعني انت في اللين ده تلاقي الناحية التانية جم ناحيتك انت بقى، يعني او الطريق فاضي يروح the wrong way، فيلاقوا نفسهم ايه قفل، فتقفل خالص، تقعد لها ساعة كده مقفولة. عشان مثلا واحد عاوز شوارع كتير انا بسوق فيها، بتلاقي واحد راكن على اليمين مش قادر تطلع قدام ولا ورا، فعاوز ترجع ورا، اللي وراك ولا عاوز يرجع واللي قدام مش عاوز يرجع، فيستك يعني. في النهايه في ناس فعلا بيسيبوا العربيه ويمشوا، يعملوا ايه؟ ياخدوا تاكسي ويرجعوا بعدين. يو كان دو ات، ورا مقفول وقدام مقفول. ففكره الصبره والمصابره لو ما عندناش السمه دي، لو ما تربطش فينا مش هنعيش، هننتحر، فمحتاجينها. بس الصبر ده قدرة الاحتمال دي بتعمل ايه؟ بتنشئ تزكية، والتزكية هي شخصية سوية، كاركتر. انا ببعي الناس في دار الكتاب اتعلمت ان كاركتر is more important than skill، مش كده؟ امناء واكفاء. فممكن في واحد يكون عنده كفاءة بس ما عندوش ايه؟ الامانة. واحد شاطر قوي لكن شخصيته زي الزفت، بينجز لكن بيبوظ كل العلاقات. فانا اقتنعت ان الشخصيه اهم من الكفاءه. انا ممكن اطور في كفاءه لكن ما اقدرش اغير الشخصيه. المسيح هنا بيغير الشخصيه، بيعمل ادابتيشن او بيصنفر او بيطور الشخصيه. فبيقول الصبر ينشئ تزكيه او شخصيه سويه. فشايفين ازاي الضيقات بتنشئ صبر، قدر احتمال، ولما انت بتتعلم تتحمل انت شخصيتك بتقوى، تبقى شخصية كده قوية وعميقة، ومش مؤاخذة فافي يعني، مش خفيف كده. في مسيحيين كتار كل عاوزينه حاجات يعني كده شوية يعني طمأنينة. الحياة مع المسيح كويسة ما دام المسيح بيديني اللي أنا عاوزه. اليوم المسيح ما يدينيش اللي أنا عاوزه، واتأثرت قوي من شهادة أخونا الدكتور ديفيد، إزاي لما توفى أبوه وأمه بيقول لربنا ليه أنت عملت فيها كده؟ دي مش الخطة، دي مش ده مش الاتفاق اللي أنا عندي معاك. لكن ربنا علمه من خلال الظروف دي، غير في شخصيته. بيقول ده كان اهم يوم في حياته لما قبل انه يقبل من ربنا. دي غيرت في شخصيته، ما ادتوش مهارات في الطب، ما ادلوش قدره اكتر، لكن غيرت في الشخصيه اللي اهم من المهارات. فعشان كده دي مهمه. بولس بيقول نفتخر في ايضا نفتخر في الضيقات عالمين ان، يعني في اسباب، احنا مش ناس بنحب بس الضيقات، لكن عارفين ان من غير الضيقات مش هنوصل نتيجه المطلوبة. الصبر ينشئ التزكية، واحنا كلنا عايزين نكون شخصية سوية. واللي عدى في الضيقات بتحسه كده انه هادي وفاهم وعميق، ممكن يكون صغير في السن ويكون عنده ماتيوريتي، تحسه كده انه شخص تقيل ده الشخصية اللي عاوزينها. لكن ناس تانيين ممكن ناس متحمسين قوي بيكلموا عن المسيح اول ما يلاقوا مشكلة يقعوا او يزعلوا او يتعصبوا. زي الزواج، اللي ياخد الزواج، حد قال اللي يدخل الزواج عشان ياخد حاجة، لو اتنين دخلوا الزواج كل واحد عاوز ياخد محدش هياخد. واحنا ما بنعلمش الناس ان فكرة الزواج انت بتجوز عشان تدي مش عشان تاخد. completely counter cultural. انا بتجوز عشان عاوز، ما ينفعش. انت لازم في الفكر المسيحي تتجوز عشان تعطي. A very different. Okay, it's counter cultural. والنزيجة اللي تنفع الواحد اللي مش بيدي عشان ياخد، بيدي زي المسيح بيدي عشان بيحب ومش مستني ياخد، فلما ياخد تبقى بونس. فده نوع الشخصية اللي عاوزة تتبني في الزواج، في العلاقات، في الحاجات. فمحتاجين، واللي بنجوز مغرف في ديكارت. فيش واحد هنا متجوز ما مغرش في ديكارت، صح؟ إلا لو محدش مغرف في ديكارت يبقى يمكن عايش في عالم تاني. لكن الزواج مش سهل، وإن أكون أب لأولاد أو أم لأولاد مش سهل. هنمغرف في ديكارت، لكن ديكارت هتخلق شخصية هتكون زي المسيح اللي هي فعلا هتستمر، واحنا عاوزين كلنا كده. والشخصيه دي السويه التزكيه بتنشئ ايه؟ بتنشئ رجاء. فاهمين ازاي؟ بتنشئ رجاء. ليه ايه الرجاء بقى؟ الرجاء مش امل، الرجاء حاجه بعرف فعلا ان مفيش حاجه تقدر تفصلني من محبه الرب يسوع، مفيش حاجه ممكن تفصلني من رب من محبه ربنا. ده الرجاء. الرجاء ان اختبر ربنا معايا في الظروف الصعبة، فأقول مفيش ظرف صعب هيفصلني عن المسيح. فأنت بتقول أوكي تعالوا على عواصف العالم، تعالوا كل المشاكل، أنا تبع المسيح وأنا الرجاء بتاعي مش هيتهز عشان رجائي في المسيح. ده نوع التذكير. فبولس كان بيقول جيبوا الديكات، عاوزين الديكات عشان بتنشئ التلات حاجات دي المهمة، الصبر والتزكية والرجاء. وفي النهاية الصبر والتزكية بيوصلوك للرجاء، واحنا عاوزين نعيش في رجاء، رجاء مسيحي مش رجاء بتاع العالم. يعني رجاء العالم واحد عنده فلوس بيخسرها. انا مش هدخل في القصص عشان وقتنا. طيب النقطه الثانيه او الاخيره هي في الايه الخامسه. الايه الخامسه بتقول والرجاء لا يخزي لان محبه الله قد انسكبت في قلوبنا ايه؟ بالروح القدس المعطى لينا. الرجاء ده جارانتيد، مضمون. من مين؟ من ربنا. شهادة الجارانتي جاية من ربنا فوق. لا يخزي، يعني it will not let you down, does not disappoint. انتوا بتشتروا حاجات كتيرة في السوق بيكون عليها جارانتي. الجارانتي لما يكون كويس من حد أعلى وأكبر. أنا مرة اشتريت كمبيوتر في مطار هيفو من ديكسون محل بيبيع حاجات. فروحت مصر بتوع قلت بقى كل المصريين مش عاوز أدفع جمارك كده، فرميت كل العلب، رميت كل حاجه من الكمبيوتر، فاخدت الكمبيوتر بس في الشنطه. رحت في مصر الاي تي جاي بتاعي قال لي ده كمبيوتر ما ينفعكش كيت. كنت صرفت فلوس و I was very disappointed. السكرتير قالت معلش نرجعه. لا نرجعه ازاي؟ رمينا البوكس ورمينا كل حاجه، ما فيش حاجه فاضله، والجارنتي بيقول اسبوع وعدينا اسبوع. قالت لا انت اشتريته من هيفو ايربورت. دخلت على الانترنت لقيت ان هيفو ايربورت بيضمن لك اي حاجه تشتريها 3 اشهر. طب ما فيش باكينج. قالت له هي فيسم مش محتاجين باكينج. طب الشحن هم يدفعوا الشحن؟ ده مش ممكن. ففعلا بعتنا لهم الجهاز، دفعوا الشحن ورجعوا لي فلوسي من غير الباكج. عشان ايه؟ مش اشتريته من محل ديكسون، اشتريته من هيفو ايربورت تبع الحكومه البريطانيه وهم بيضمنوا المطار. ده دعايه لهيفو يعني. بس فاهمين الفرق؟ الرجاء بتاع ربنا ده جارانتي اعلى، جارانتي من فوق. It will not let you down. It will not disappoint. ده الجارانتي اللي عندنا. It's not a small guarantee من شركة كده أو من كنيسة أو من حاجة. الجارانتي مش جاي من الأسيس أو من الكنيسة، جاي من فوق. Signed and sealed by God. It will not disappoint. فبولوس is excited. بيقول our hope cannot be disappointed. ما فيش حاجة تقدر تفصلنا عن محبة المسيح. إحنا كنا في جنازة صعبة قوي من 3 أسابيع، من أصعب الحاجات اللي مرت في مصر. أخت مؤمنة ممتازة بتروح الشغل الصبح، عربية نقل رايحة طريق اتجاه عكسي في أوتوستراد في مصر، فعصتها خلاص، ماتت آخر على الآخر في دقايق كانت راحت. وملاكة. فالجنازة كانت في قصر دبي، كان مليانة، ما كانش فيها إنجيلي في مصر، ما كانش في الجنازة. Everybody knew. كل القيادات المسيحية، الجنازة was full. البنت دي كانت عمرها 42 سنة. انا استني، انا كنت مع جوزها الاسبوع اللي فات، قبل ما اجي يوم قبل ما اجي رحت اشوف جوزها، كنت متاخرت الزياره، بقول له ما اعرفش اقول لك ايه، هقول لك ايه. المهم دخلت فكانوا كل البنات لابسين ابيض، كل اصغر بقى البنات لابسين ابيض. قلت ازاي ايه؟ قال لي عشان هي كانت عاوزه كده. قلت له طب هي ماتت؟ لا، قالت قبل ما تموت بكتير قالت في جنازتي عاوزه كل الناس يلبسوا ابيض. قبل حاجه مش معقوله. فالبنات لبسوا ابيض، واز فيري اكسايتنج يعني، فيري موفينج. ستات في مصر بيلبسوا اسود، فالكنيسه كلها كانت لابسه ابيض، لدرجه ان ناس ستات قالوا لي راحوا بحاجه سودا، جاكيت سودا فوق الابيض، خايفين يعني، خايفين يدخلوا الناس يزعلوا منهم، وكلهم لقوا كله لابس ابيض. بنتها اسمها جلوري 17 سنه، قامت واتكلمت في جنازه امها. I don't know how she did it يعني. قالت ماما كانت جاهزه قبل المسيح، الوحيده مننا كانت جاهزه وربنا كان عاوزها. وقالت انا ما اعرفش ليه ربنا اخدها، لكن انا بقول لكم النهارده ان رب امي مع المسيح اللي افضل ليها. احنا كلنا ما فيش حد اللي بيبكي. 17 سنه بنت بتحكي عن الايمان، ضمان الرجاء هو حب ربنا ليها، وحب ربنا انسكب في قلب البنت دي. يعني كنت تتوقع البنت بقى تبقى زعلانه زي ما قال ديفيد ان 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 ابوه وامه لما ماتوا، يعني ليه ربنا؟ لا، البنت دي كان لها سلام جه من ربنا ونعمه. وما شفت ابوها قالت لي هي اقوى واحده فينا دلوقتي، هي شايله البيت، تقول لي انا منهار واخوها منهار، هي شايلانا. الرجاء لا يخزي، ما بيخبش، لان الروح القدس معطى لنا في الماضي، وحب الله قد انسكب في قلوبنا وما زال. اوكي، ادانا الروح القدس في الماضي وبيسكب حب الله فينا في الظروف دي وما زال. فلو النهارده انت او انت عاوزين سلام حقيقي ونعمه عميقه حقيقيه ورجاء قوي، الطريق الذي وصفه الله هو طريق الديكات مع عمل الروح القدس فينا. فزي ما قال بولس احنا بنفتخر في الحاجات دي، نفتخر ايضا في الديكات، عالمين ان الضيق ينشئ حاجات مهمة في حياتنا. فإخوة أخوات، الحياة المسيحية واقعية حقيقية، مش عاوزين نزورها، مش عاوزين نديها يعني نترجمها بطريقة ما تكونش بتواجه الواقع، لكن إيماننا المسيحي قوي كفاية إن يواجه الواقع. وأي ضيق، مكتبة اتحرقت، كنائس اتحرقت، أم ماتت، أي حاجة نمر فيها، إيماننا المسيحي بيدي ده رجاء كلمة ربنا. عشان كده إحنا بنفتخر بكلمة ربنا، بنفتخر في الحاجات دي عشان عارفين انه ده اللي احنا عاوزينه. احنا يعني المسيح هو الوحيد في المجتمع اللي يقدر يقف براسه فوق ويقول انا عندي جارانتي من فوق، انا عندي الانشورنس اللي هتاخدني السماء، ايترنال انشورنس، والشركة will never go bankrupt، وما فيش حاجة. ده الانشورنس الوحيد اللي احنا عايشينه. ربنا باركنا كلنا وخلينا نعيش الكلمات دي، خمس ايات قصيرين لكن شايفين عمق الكلمة. فصلونا احنا في مصر نقدر نوصل كلمة ربنا الغنية دي لكل العالم العربي، لكل الناس، ده أملنا. وبنشتغل في منتجات كتيرة بنحاول نوصلها عشان الكلمة الغنية دي تكون الانتي بودي، تكون الانتي بيوتيك اللي يساعد الناس يعرفوا يعيشوا حياتهم. ربنا يبارككم، وانا يعني شرف اكون معاكم وشرف اشارك معاكم النهاردة الصبح. امين.
نحن رؤوسنا بالصلاة بالكلمة المعزية فيها النهار والرجاء، أي رجاء الله لا يخزي، لأن محبة الله قد انسكبت في قلوبنا بالروح القدس. يعني ربنا ربطك بمحبته الأبدية، محبة المسيح التي لا يقدر أحد ولا قوة في الأرض وفي السماء أن تفصلك عن محبة الله في المسيح، لأن الروح القدس قد انسكب في قلبك، وهذا الروح لن يزعه إلى الأبد. وهذا الروح المعزي يعطيك رجاء، إن كنت في ظروف صعبة أو إن كنت في ألام أو كنت في ضيقات أو في أوقات صعبة، ارفع عينيك إلى هناك حيث يأتي عونك. الروح القدس يعزيك، هناك رجاء، هناك فسحة للأمل. قل له يا رب انت افتح لي باب لن يغلقه احد، باب الرجاء من عندك. مادام أنت معي أنا قلبي مرتاح. سلم قلبك إلى الرب في هذا الصباح، إذا ما بتعرفه كمخلص أو سيد، قل له يا رب طهر قلبي، نقيني من جديد، سمحني لأنه عنتك بالماضي، سمحني على أخطائي وخطاياي الكثيرة، سمحني لأنه ظنيت حالي أني أنا عندي بر، أنا آتي إليك في هذا الوقت، ارحمني أنا الخاطي. ما أعظم محبتك، تريدني أن أكون واحد من أولادك، عندك خطة لأجل حياتي. يا سيدي أنا أسلمك نفسي وأقبلك كسيدي ومخلصي، تربع على عرش قلبي، أقبل موتك وأقبل قيامتك لي لأجلي، فبررني وطهرني بالإيمان بعملك لأجلي على الصليب، واعطني هبة الحياة الأبدية، واجعلني ذلك الإنسان الذي تريدني أن أكونه. وإذا كنت واحد من أولاد الرب، قل له يا رب أنت تعرف الأمواج وتعرف الظروف، تعرف الغيوم السوداء، ولكن أنت تشرق بوجهك علي ونورك يضيء في وسط الظلمة، ولن يقدر أحد أن يخطفني من يدك، أنا إليك إلى الأبد. عزيني وشجعني وأنت خذ بيدي وقدني. هناك شوق في أعماق كثيرين في هذه القاعة أن يكونوا رجال ونساء بحسب قلبك. بارك من كلمنا في هذا اليوم يا رب، الدكتور ديفيد وأخونا الحبيب رامز وكل الذين استخدمتهم لكي يلمسوا قلوبنا في هذا المؤتمر. بارك أولادك في هذه الكنيسة وأولادك الذين أتوا من خارج، من مدن مختلفة في أمريكا وفي خلف البحار. وأقم لك يا رب شعب في هذه الأيام الأخيرة بقية مقدسة، أن تقف بالثغر ونكون بالفعل رجال ونساء بحسب قلبك، باسمك وبسلطانك أيها الرب يسوع المسيح، آمين.
أنت عالي فوق كل اسم مهما يكون، عالي فوق السحاب ومال الكون، عالي وهتشوف ملكك كل العيون، عالي ملك الملوك وجلالك.
ملك الملوك وجلالك، مال الوجود حوالينا، وجبال بتدوب قدامك، اسمك عالي يا فدينا. ملك الملوك وجلالك، مال الوجود حوالينا، وجبال بتدوب قدامك، اسمك عالي يا فدينا. الأنهار بتسقف لك، كل الآلات تعزف لك، ويا ربي بكلمة منك كل الملوك تخضع لك. انت عالي فوق كل عالي، فوق السحاب ومال الكون، هتشوف ملكك كل العيون، عالي انت عالي.
قولا
كل العيون، عالي.
قولا كمان مرة معي،
ملك مال الوجود وجبال
قدامك اسمك عالي يا فدينا الأنهار بتسقف لك ويا رب بكلمة منك كل الملوك تخضع لك انت عالي فوق كل اسمي مهما يكون عالي فوق السحاب ومال الكون عالي هتشوف ملكك كل العيون عالي انت عالي فوق كل اسم مهما يكون عالي فوق السحاب وما للكون عالي هتشوف ملكك كل العيون عالي